Hello, everyone. I'd like to thank everyone for allowing me the opportunity to speak at this committee. So my name is Alana Murray. Before I talk about my transport experiences, I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself to kind of put, you know, a face and a story to the statistics. So I'm an award-winning filmmaker, first and foremost. My documentary on disability within the screen media industry toured the festival circuit and finished its festival run with an award win. Another one of my films recently premiered in Portugal and was also award nominated. I'm a TEDx speaker and I'm also fluent in Irish. I'm about to graduate with a BA honours degree in film and television production, and I have my eyes set on a master's programme. I, along with many others like me, am the future of your country. Yet, with all these impressive attributes, I can't get on a bus of my own free will. I'm forced to give details about where I'm going to be, what time I'll be there, what time I intend on coming back. Maybe I wouldn't mind if the system worked, but it doesn't. Time and time again, myself and others like me are let down by this deeply flawed and unrealistic system. I'm 21 years old. At 21, I should be allowed to be spontaneous. I should be free to hop on a bus and explore our country. The country whose constitution was built on the idea of freedom, of equality. I ask those of you here today, when did we stray so far from the visions of our forefathers? Because I would not be sat here today in front of you all if this was still a country of freedom and equality. You see, even when jumping through all these transportation hoops, the system still continues to let me down. In last year alone, I'd say I was let down by our transport system over 20 times. I've missed out on business meetings that could have secured me with a job. I've had to miss appointments because I've showed up to my pre-booked bus to be told that there was a miscommunication and I would be unable to travel because the bus had not been properly adapted to allow me on. Because you still have to adapt the bus in order to let me on. It is not completely accessible. I've missed out on valuable opportunities to spend time with my friends, leaving me isolated from them and ultimately cutting me off from the wider world. I cannot begin to describe the emotions that go through your body when you are sat at a crowded bus stop and a driver has to step off and tell you that you will not be travelling simply because you have a disability. This has happened time and time again. So you're sat there and you see the crowds of people whispering to each other. Sympathetic looks are exchanged. Then the bus pulls away and you're left sat there, alone, feeling like you are nothing. Then there's the email that you have to send, or the text, letting your prospective business partner, employer, friend, whatever it is, that you will be unable to attend your pre-arranged meeting. Who's going to be the one that salvages my reputation when I'm labelled as unreliable? When I'm unable to get a job and I'm forced to feed into the stereotype that people with disabilities do not work? When I'm cut off from the rest of society because the thoughts of getting a bus are too much for me and I decide that I'm better staying at home? I am too young to be jaded, to feel this jaded by a system that can be fixed. We are fighting, but we can't do it alone. There are the people that are trying their best to help. I've had bus drivers put themselves at risk to lift me onto buses because they refuse to accept the broken system, and they are committed to making sure that I reach the destination on the journey that I have pre-booked 24 hours in advance. There are people like Ciarán Delaney, like Senator John Dolan, who will stop at nothing until people with disabilities are given the rights that they deserve. Ciarán, who has had to make phone calls just to make sure that I don't get stranded in Dublin because of a grievous error that I assure you has never been any fault of mine. There was one night in particular where I sat in Bus Aris and I was told that I would not be travelling and that they'd try and accommodate me on the next bus. The next bus came, they couldn't. The next bus came, they couldn't. It was getting dark and I was genuinely concerned that I would not make it home. I thought, what am I going to do? I checked hotels, everywhere was booked. I was terrified that I was going to end up stranded or just abandoned with no way home. And that is the reality of this system. Then there are the times where I have gotten on the bus and there have been no clamps. And they have offered to put my chair in the cargo hold while I transfer into a chair. That's well and good, I'm able to do that. but I shouldn't have to. I shouldn't have to risk my chair being put in the cargo hold where it could be broken. If my chair gets broken, I automatically become helpless and dependent, and I assure you that I am neither helpless or dependent. Tell me, do you think that this is acceptable in 2018 Ireland? My life is complicated enough without having to anxiously chew at my fingernails, wondering whether I'm going to be able to make my pre-booked journey, a journey that I am forced to book in advance because people with disabilities are an afterthought in your system. I admire the introduction of the four-hour plan, but it's not enough. 24 hours notice bus journey is not enough. Public transport should not be a human rights issue, but in its current form, it is. I ask you here today, what is it going to take for you to take into account the plight of people with disabilities using your service and to properly implement change? How many more people are going to give up and be forced to become isolated, wards of a system that is exclusionary and ultimately dangerous? I reject the idea that I should have to book my journey. I reject being in any way different from you or your colleagues. You do not have to book transport in advance. So why do I? No more being left on the side of the road. No more having to call in favours just to get home. No more missed opportunities. No more feeling like a burden for wanting to live independently in society. No more discrimination against people with disabilities. I promise you, fixing this system is a lot easier than having me at your door to contend with. Enough is enough. Thank you.
I'd like to thank
My name is Pádraig Moore, and I have cerebral palsy, which basically impairs my motor function, so I require a power chair to get from A to B. I work for Sky Ireland as a service specialist. I work for East Coast FM as a production assistant, sports reporter, and broadcast coordinator. So Sky Ireland are based in Burlington Road, so I do the commute every day from Bray to Baldbridge for the last 3.5 years. So I've kind of seen it from the point that stations were manned to where we are now, and it's gotten progressively worse in that. And well, most people don't realise this: people with disabilities or impairments don't like asking for help, and it's a very humbling experience that we have to ask for assistance. But we have to do it in certain points. So for things like transport, we should be fully independent and autonomous to go and get on a bus or get on a train, not having to give 4 hours notice, not having to give 24 hours notice. It's not fair. If any of the, and I use this term, able-bodied population had to do that, people wouldn't stand for it because it is against human rights. And we're, in Ireland, we seem to do things and then we retrospectively go back and say, you know what, that doesn't work. I'm highlighting a few incidents that have come into the public domain purely because I work in media. I know how the system works. I know how to get a reaction. Other people can't. Last August, I left work and I communicated with Pierce Station. Now, I'm lucky because I have such a good relationship with the staff in Station and Irish Rail. I have personal mobile numbers. That's how it doesn't happen to me more than it does, because I've actually good relationships with the majority of the staff. So last August, I was coming home at about 8:30, 9 o'clock after doing my shift in Sky, and it was communicated to Bray that I was on the Dart. So I got to Bray, nobody there, and I was like, right, I'm stuck. So you might say, why didn't I press the emergency button? For the simple reason, the emergency button on the Darts at wheelchair level are never armed. They're a mere decoration. So I had to wedge my chair in against the wall, try and stand up and break the little piece of plastic to push the one that's up on a wall. That went off. When I ended up in Greystones, I went, oh yeah, that actually went off, but I thought it was an error and never checked. So I could have been attacked. I could have been having an asthma attack. Anything could have been happening. He didn't bother to actually check what had happened. I lodged a complaint with the Railway Safety Authority in relation to that incident. They never followed up. So, again, you're lodging a complaint. For what reason? Because they simply, nobody follows up and it's, oh, we're very sorry, we're this, we're that, the other, but nobody actually does anything. Last December, the 17th of December, I was coming home again from on a Sunday evening, and the Darts only go every half an hour, so it's kind of, you've got to plan which one you're going to get. So again, I arrived, I rang Pierce, they sent the guy from Sandymount up to put me on the train. He communicated to Bray, I got to Bray, there was nobody there. I couldn't get to the emergency button at the other level. I couldn't break the little piece of plastic, so off I went to Greystones. I Facebook Live that experience, and for the second time I called on the CEO of Irish Rail to come out and actually speak to me, and for want of it, it had to grow a set, because it's very easy to make cuts, but it's harder to stand in front of someone who has a face that's directly affected by the cuts and fully impacted this. So I went to Greystones. The thing with this was the Dart had to get out of the way because the Rosslare train was coming up, so the door starts to close. I had to stick my legs out the door to keep the door open. It took the driver 5 minutes to come down and check why the doors weren't closing. So I ended up with a swollen ankle because of this. If I hadn't have stuck my legs out the door, I would have ended up on a siding because it had to get out of the way to let the Rosslare train came up. And then I had to hope and pray that the Rosslare train driver would get off and put me on, because not all the Irish Rail drivers are insured to put ramps down. And they're not insured to leave their cabs, because if there's an incident, they're in trouble. So that's another big issue, in that, you know, there's no safety protocols in place, and all you get from Irish Rail is lip service. It keeps happening. If something keeps happening, you fix it. You don't just keep putting paper over the cracks, which they're very good at doing and getting away with, because nothing is happening. And no one in Irish Rail seems to be answerable or trying to fix it. And that's a fundamental issue. I had an interview with Barry Kenny back in East Coast FM in December, where he talked about automated ramps for Dart. Automated ramps were piloted about 10 years ago. They had to abandon that for the simple reason that the infrastructure in some of the Dart stations is so old. So in certain stations like Seapoint, if it's an 8-carriage Dart, you have to be on carriage 3, because there's no space anywhere else on the platform to go. And when I argued this point with Barry Kenny, he totally dismissed this and went, oh, well, the platforms are all the same length. Yes, they are all the same length. I'm not arguing that. What I'm arguing was you've an infrastructure problem, and that's part of the reason they had to abandon it, because they couldn't fit the infrastructure or the ramps around the infrastructure, because it's too old. And when they piloted this before, they looked at it and they were told they would have to redesign the system, and that would fundamentally cost too much money. Part of their other argument is that, you know, there's people not talking at windows or you know, they're not making revenue because you've got leap cards. Irish Rail are still getting the money from the leap card. They're not getting that. So that's another issue. They are getting the money. Taking staff out of stations is the biggest issue. Now, because I'm in full-time employment, I'm no longer entitled to the travel pass, because I got cured when I got a job, according to the system. So, you know, I inadvertently probably set a trap for Irish Rail a couple of months ago when I made this public knowledge. Last Thursday evening, when I was leaving work, I got 3 separate phone calls from 3 staff in 3 different stations on the Dart system telling me the Revenue Protection Unit were out to catch me without a ticket. Now, what they don't know is I obviously buy my ticket now because I have to, and I don't mind that. But this was a ploy from them to set me up, to get me to go away, to stop giving out, to stop fighting for people. My fundamental argument is I'm lucky with my cerebral palsy. I can talk, I can communicate, I can articulate and say, this is wrong. Some people with disabilities and parents can't do that. According to the last census, there's just over 600,000 people registered with disabilities. It's a lot easier to make cuts because we're not a big voting group. We can't get out in mass protests. Last year, this whole country was discommoded by a bus strike, and it got sorted out. Why? Because the whole population was discommoded. People with disabilities are discommoded every single day, but it's acceptable. Because we can't mass protest. We can't get out and say this is wrong because there's so few that are actually able to do it. So for the ones that don't have a voice, that's when myself and Alana are sitting here, because we have to fight for the ones that can't fight for everybody else. I've said that I'm really lucky in that I'm a 2-time Paralympic athlete. I've travelled around the world to Beijing, to Portugal, to Brazil, to Canada. I've seen many different transport systems. When I was in Porto in 2016, I could go get on their tram system and get into the city centre by myself without assistance. I could do it in Paris. I went over to Wales for the Ireland match last November. I got on a train because people are there. If Europe can do it, why can't Ireland? It's very simple. Why, like, in Ireland, we've got this knack of building things and then not following up on systems. Like, we build it and then we realise we've made a mistake instead of actually doing it. From the outset, if you look at last week, Irish Rail launched their accessibility app. I'm actually on the committee for that app. That app hasn't been fully tested. I'm going in next Wednesday to test that app with Irish Rail. They launched that in Connolly Station. They left two people on a platform. Connolly Station has the most staff in any Dart station. If they can't get it right on a launch, what hope do the rest of us have for the rest of the time that they are going to get it right? I'm really lucky that I'm here today because of Kieran Delaney, Senator John Dolan, because without them, I wouldn't know this was even possible. And because I was so distressed last Thursday, they were so good in trying to help me in terms of the Revenue Protection Unit. And Deputy Brady can attest to the state that I was in. So can Aisling Dunn, because she also rang me to make sure I was okay. So I'm having to get help from a system that should be there. We're now on the cusp of something great, where we're just about to ratify the UN Convention for Persons with Disabilities. You guys have the chance to actually make the system work and not accept this. The problem is, it's accepted because we can't mass protest, and that's part of the problem. I shouldn't, like Alana, have to ring Kieran Delaney in a panic or ring Deputy Brady and say, I'm in trouble because the system is broken and a company wants to try and get me to go away. Like, it shows a lot of contempt by the outgoing CEO of Irish Rail that he doesn't want to meet me and won't respond to me. And I get Barry Kenny, I get Jane Creagan, and I get their PR people. I don't want them. I want him. I want him to sit down and say, this is why this is happening. Because I guarantee you, if Irish Rail said tomorrow, or RTE 61 News announced that every citizen in this country had to give 4 hours' notice to use transport, it wouldn't happen. Because it would be sorted out, because that's the whole country. Because a minority group is being discommoded, it's almost like we're not respected as humans, and that's a fundamental issue that needs to be addressed. And as I said, only for the likes of Kieran, I wouldn't be here today. Kieran is doing his best to try and help and highlight issues, but again, as Alana said, we shouldn't have to do that. We shouldn't be here. The system should be there and in place to protect us. And that's fundamentally what I want. It's not about me. It's not about me getting the dart. It's about fundamentally protecting people that can't communicate. Like, I know people that would have a speech impediment. If they're to pick up a phone and use a touch talker, the person at the other end of the phone doesn't know that. So if it takes them 30 or 40 seconds to, you know, type something out, that person isn't going to wait. So fundamentally, you know, we need to protect people with disabilities and give them equal rights. We shouldn't be saying this is what we need to do because of cutbacks. Put staff in stations. We've 13 billion coming back from Apple. There's money that could put staff back in stations. There's something that could be used to build a better infrastructure. There's stuff that could be used to give people equal rights. Not lip service, not saying, well, we're going to try. I'm tired of getting apologies. It's got to the point now, Irish Rail don't even apologise to me because it happens so much. And the other issue that you would also have in stations before the outgoing CEO came in, it used to tell you when lifts were out of order. That's not there anymore because simply he didn't want negative publicity. I don't know about you guys, I'd much rather that on the board than an article in The Independent saying I couldn't get out of the station because the lifts were broken. So I'm really lucky that I've travelled and I've seen different systems. But I implore you guys, and I spoke to Minister Ross last week, and I know he is trying to deal with it, but he's only dealing with it now because people like myself and Alana are bringing it to the public forefront. We shouldn't have to do that. Like, as TDs, senators, politicians, you guys are supposed to look after what are deemed to be vulnerable in society. Some people with disabilities are really vulnerable. They're not being looked after. They're not being protected. Thank you for listening.